hopefully contributions made from all our contributors. And our last speaker is Trenton Oldfield, who you may remember was the shot to fame with the boat race protester, was arrested and jailed and had to fight against deportation. And we'll speak a little bit, I think, about what we were protesting about and the invention of the force before we open to the force. So over to you.
Thank you. It's great to be here. It's very rare for a white middle class man to have a platform to talk, especially in the Houses of Parliament. So even more delighted to be here. But, what a creepy building this is. Doesn't it like freak you up? I mean, I find it. And it just kind of drained the energy out of me as I was coming in. I don't find anything here on the spot. It just feels really heavy. I expected it to kind of be dank. Seems to be. And the logo, I don't know if you've seen the logo, but it's a gate. It's a, you know, a gate with spikes on it. I mean, what an interesting idea for a parliament. Well, it's a palace. And you probably know also that this building is not very old, even though it's trying to perform an oldness. Building about 150 years old, it took 20 years to build, which is nothing. That's like yesterday in comparison to most cultures. But it's performing something when it's trying to indicate that it's been here for, you know, 1,000 years with this kind of Gothic kind of idea. But it's brand new. It's from yesterday. I mean, everything's new. And as you probably know, before that, and it could have only really been built in the 1800s, because prior to that, there was nothing here in Europe. I mean, it was, you know, it was the Dark Ages. It's well known as the Dark Ages. It wasn't until Europeans left and had interactions with the rest of the world that they realized, holy shit, we're in trouble. So this building could have only been built in the 1800s because both the resources and the ideas didn't exist. They were taken and developed as a result of those violent interactions. So I think when we're sitting here, we need to kind of think of how this was built, where it was built, and where the ideas came from. So that kind of draws off the two things I want to talk about, which I guess I'll have to speed up, which is the ideas of white supremacy and white privilege, and who dares wins. And before I do that briefly, I hope to just make a quick comment on the current condition in the United Kingdom, which I think might touch on a couple of things here. And I think post the Second World War, around the world everybody was, you know, monarchs were losing their heads. The Raj was being, you know, disempowered. There was revolutions, and there was the establishment needed to bend or it was going to break. So it set about giving a tiny little bit to the people, so in order to prevent that break from happening, from that final overthrow. So that was things like the NHS, education, some civil rights, you know, all those things that my parents benefited massively from and continue to benefit massively from, which didn't, you know, exist in the West previously to that. And they had this incredible life where they, you know, could get jobs and all these kind of things. But it's fundamental to understand that all of that was funded and is funded by the colonial endeavour, by the war machine. It is not from here. It is funded entirely from theft and from the war. And since 1980, as people are sort of around to have pointed out, that process of that bend, that slight bend, is being pulled back into line. Dr. Gill, you might be a professor, Dr. Gill suggested that this is the final process of that line being pulled back in terms of the NHS. 1 minute. Oh my God. I'm not going to be able to speak about that. So what I'm going to say is I think the methodologies that have been used to create this kind of system at the moment is a couple of things. One is doublespeak, war is peace, having £2 million carriages to carry people, you know, where people are starving. Shock and awe methodology, which is a military tactic, but it's being used by us, where you create such so many different fronts that you can only deal with so many, and you lose your spirit of fight. Bread and circuses, which everybody knows about, you know, Olympics, football matches, etc. The other is decoys and distractions. For example, in the city of London the other day, there was an abandoned car that was left in the middle of a bank. It was big news for a day. There's not, like, on Freedom of Information Authorities, there's been not one person charged. Nobody, the City of London can't tell me the number plate, the name of the person, etc. Even though you can't get in and out of the City of London without being photographed, and nobody can. So there's all those kind of decoys and distractions. I think somebody went on the train tracks the other day down here, so there's all those kind of things. And then the final thing is the militarization of the state, and particularly the militarization of the police, and the inability as a result to be able to resist through those things. And perhaps, but the driving philosophy behind this is this concept of who dares wins. Or if you walk a little bit further down the road outside of Warmachine Street, there's a monument which has the boldest measures are the safest. So you do as much as possible in the most dramatic sense that you just couldn't believe anybody would possibly do. And that's the methodology. That's the kind of driving logic that allows those other methodologies to fall into place. But essentially, we are all benefiting from the European wars around the world.
Okay, thanks so much, Jessica.